Caitlin Harris's job is to shop.
Usually you start with produce.
She handpicks items, often at this Whole Foods outside Boston, food that other people order online.
I couldn't find the cheese that the customer asked for, so I'm gonna get a replacement for them.
Harris works for Instacart, which guarantees grocery deliveries to your home in as little as an hour. The three-year-old company offers its service in 16 cities and partners with local stores, including big chain retailers like Costco and Whole Foods. Instacart used to consider its shoppers, like Harris, independent contractors, not employees. Workers didn't earn any benefits, but the job was flexible. They could choose to work as much or as little as they wanted and got paid by the task. But last month, Instacart announced a big change. Shoppers in some markets, including Boston, would have the option to become employees.
I was happy to hear that when I was brought on, I was brought on as an employee.
For Harris, a college student who works 20 hours a week, being an employee means a guaranteed paycheck, not having to worry about setting aside money to pay her own taxes, and a stable schedule.
I like to have a set shift for the week and be able to go off of that for how my week is going to go, as opposed to picking up a shift here and there.
I spoke to Andrea Saul, Instacart's head of communications, via Google Hangout at the company's San Francisco headquarters, and asked why Instacart decided to allow their shoppers to be employees.
When you look at shopping, and grocery shopping in particular, it can be really difficult. For instance, you know, picking fresh produce or items that are prone to breaking, like eggs. There are a lot of different decisions that go into that minute by minute when you're fulfilling an order as a shopper in the store. And when the shoppers, we really saw that the supervision and oversight and training could help improve their jobs.
The company said it could provide this layer of management only with employees.
So this has to be more expensive. I mean, you have to pay Social Security tax, Medicare, workers' compensation, right? I mean, does it make economic sense for the company?
We are incurring additional cost. But what we decided was that the additional costs we're incurring on the front end to employ these additional people is worth it for the customer service in the long run.
Instacart says shoppers who become employees will be part-timers, working about 20 to 30 hours a week for up to $15 an hour. But not all Instacart workers will have the option to become employees. Drivers who deliver the groceries that Harris and other shoppers gather will remain independent contractors, Saul says, because driving doesn't require the same decision-making as shopping.
You know, right now, this is a model we're experimenting with. It could change in the future.
Heather Squire has worked for Instacart, shopping and delivering groceries in Philadelphia. But after taking a close look at her earnings and her expenses, including gas, wear and tear on her car, and parking, the job didn't make sense.
I discovered that I was getting screwed, is what I felt. I felt angry. I didn't think it was that bad. I did not think it would, be below minimum wage.
After a few weeks with Instacart, Squire calculated she had earned about $6 an hour after taxes and decided to quit. Squire says a set hourly wage would outweigh the freedom of being a contractor.
So it's a little bit misleading to say that, oh, the flexibility. It's like, that's good, but why do we have to be flexible? I'm trying to be flexible around a part-time job and another gig because there's not enough, good-paying full-time jobs out there.
While Instacart has started to categorize some of its workers as employees, there's no company closer to the center of this debate than on-demand car service Uber. Available in hundreds of cities around the world, Uber says it's just a technology company putting passengers and drivers together. The company says its drivers are independent contractors.
Companies engage in all kinds of linguistic gymnastics to try to deny the obvious and try to claim that they're not in the business that they're obviously in.
Boston attorney Shannon Liss Reardon says Uber, the company that calls itself everyone's private driver, is clearly a car service.
I've seen in a number of industries companies passing off their expenses to their workers, saving on labor costs, doing really the same thing that the so-called new economy companies are doing. In the cleaning industry, the construction industry, the trucking industry, the adult entertainment industry, the call center industry, one big company will do it, and all the other companies think that it's okay and they'll go along with it.
Liss Reardon has filed a class action lawsuit against Uber in California. alleging its drivers have been misclassified as independent contractors who should be reimbursed for all expenses, including gas and maintenance. As employees, drivers would also be subjected to minimum wage and overtime laws. The legal standard to determine whether a worker is a contractor or an employee is not simple. The Internal Revenue Service has a 20-point test. The Department of Labor lists 6 general factors for consideration. Many states have their own criteria. Liz Reardon says a key issue in the Uber case is how much control the company maintains over its drivers.
The evidence that we have is that while Uber drivers are driving for Uber, they are subject to Uber's rules. They can be deactivated if they don't follow them. They can be deactivated if Uber management is unhappy with them. If their customer ratings dip a little bit, they're subject to termination.
Uber declined an interview, but told us in a statement how drivers control their time and their use of the app make clear that drivers are independent contractors under today's standards.
So you have the app on now. It says where the surge pricing is.
Richard Krenzel drove for Uber in New Jersey for a year and a half, a career change after losing his job in the financial industry. Krenzel had issues with Uber. The app doesn't allow customers to tip drivers, but he liked being in charge.
The flexibility is tremendous. You want to go visit relatives, whatever, you want to go on a trip for a day, you can rotate everything, and there's no one saying you can't do it. You're your own person, and you can work when you want.
That's a common sentiment. 87% of Uber drivers say they work for Uber to be my own boss and set my own schedule, according to a survey the company commissioned this year. The company also points out that Uber drivers are permitted to simultaneously work for rivals like Lyft and Sidecar. Still, attorney Shannon Liz Reardon says that flexibility provided by sharing economy companies does not mean true independence. She's also sued Lyft, the cleaning company Homejoy, and courier services Postmates and Caviar.
Here you have entire companies that are building their business model off of having the services that they provide be provided by a mass of workers who they want to label as running their own independent businesses. And it's just not true, because these so-called independent contractors are completely dependent on the company for that work.
In June, a California labor commissioner decided one Uber driver should be classified as an employee, a ruling the company is appealing. In Liz Reardon's class action lawsuit, the judge has allowed the case to proceed, writing whether Uber's drivers are employees or independent contractors is an issue to be decided by a jury, setting the stage for a lengthy court battle. The fight is not just in courts, it's also on the campaign trail. While Democrat Hillary Clinton has said she would crack down on companies that misclassify employees as contractors, Republican presidential candidate Jeb Bush has made a point to ride with Uber drivers, and fellow Republican Rand Paul tweeted, "Services like Uber, Airbnb, and Lyft stimulate our economy and work towards lower prices. How is this bad, Hillary Clinton?" How its drivers are classified is not the only battle Uber is fighting. The ride-sharing app has been in conflict with existing taxi fleets and regulators around the world. Just as sharing economy companies upend entire industries, New York University Business School professor Arun Sundararajan argues worker classifications need to be rethought altogether.
We're sort of in a phase where the model of providing a few hours at a time or providing to multiple platforms may in fact be the most economically efficient one.
Sundararajan believes traditional workplace benefits like insurance and paid vacation should be separated from one's employer.
To me, sort of the humane thing isn't to make everybody a full-time employee, but to extend the safety net to cover people who have alternative forms of work.
Instacart's Andrea Saul agrees that laws may need to be updated.
I do think that a lot of times people are trying to fit a square peg in a round hole in regards to what the employment system looks like these days.
In the meantime, Instacart has expanded where its shoppers will have the option to become employees to 7 cities, nearly half its locations.